Good morning all. We welcome you all on behalf of GripYourNet for this special lecture on history of English literature, social and political background. So in this pandemic situation, every one of us will be clueless about when and how to start your preparation. And of all this, we all are clueless about when our exams will be. And that for that we have got a solution now that NTA NET has closed the application for NET exam on June 30th, and yesterday they have released a notice that applicants can make corrections in their applications. So this can be done between 6th to 15th of July. So participants, kindly make note of this. We have also shared this in our Telegram group. So basically, to make this pandemic time valuable, we have started this online platform to make every NET aspirant to grip their NET. So for the past 2 months, I will admit a few people who are waiting in their room.
செமினார் போயிட்டு இருக்கு மேம். கொஞ்சம் நான் ஒரு நோட் மட்டும்
தருவேன். மியூட் யுவர் ஆடியோ. பார்ட்டிசிபென்ட்ஸ் கைண்ட்லி மியூட் யுவர் ஆடியோ. So for the past 2 months, we had crash courses on literary theory and criticism, and then we had crash course on teaching and research aptitude. So now we have moved on to this new venture on the course series on British literature, which is very, very essential part in paper 2 of NET exam. So this we have chosen because 30 to 40% of the questions in NET exam is from British literature. So we have chosen to have this special lecture on history because social and political background is very, very essential part, and it cannot be separated from learning the literature. So that's why we thought of having this special lecture by our guest speaker today, so that we made our aspirants to have to make benefit out of this. So let's have few tips on how to prepare for NET and why we have started this British literature course and how we provide materials, and everything will be discussed towards the end of this session after the special lecture. So please stay with us to know all the other details. So now we'll move on to the next session without making any other time. We can move on to introduce our speaker of today. So now I welcome Mrs. Swati to introduce our speaker.
Happy morning, everyone. It gives us immense pleasure to introduce our guest of honor today. So we are happy to introduce our resource person, Mrs. Nisha Krishnaswamy. Presently, she is working as Assistant Professor of English at Sri Parashakti College for Women, Gujralam. And she completed her UG degree from the same college. She completed PG from Holy Cross College, Nagarkoil, and her MPhil from Scott Christian College, Nagarkoil. Now she is doing her PhD at Research Center of Sri Parashakti College for Women, Gujralam, in Indian mythic fiction. She has published various papers and has great flair for literature. So it gives us immense pleasure to have a session on you, ma'am. So we look forward to your session. We welcome Mrs. Nisha Krishnaswamy.
Thank you, Swati. Am I audible?
Yeah, yes, ma'am, you are audible. Yeah.
Shall I start?
You can start, yeah. Yes, ma'am, you can start.
Good morning. Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah, ma'am, you are audible. You are audible. Yeah.
Thank you. Good morning all. First of all, I thank GripYourNet team, Swati ma'am and Madhubala for giving me this opportunity. I appreciate GripYourNet team for their efforts. They do a wonderful job with their net coaching. It's marvelous. Along with the lectures, they revise tests, give, discuss the lapses made by the aspirants. So I wish them all the best in all their endeavors. And I really deem it a privilege indeed to present this topic amongst this august and learned professionals. This is my maiden attempt at as a resource person for an online program. As you all know, it's a wide topic. As far as possible, I have attempted to include everything in this lecture. Kindly bear with me if there is any lapses and technical glitches. Do suggest me with your opinions for improvement at the end of the talk. Thank you all. With prayers to Almighty and seeking blessings of my parents and well-wishers, I am starting my session today. Madhu, can you share the screen? First, before going there, I'll give you an introduction about the topic. So today's topic, History of English Literature.
Is the screen visible? Background. Sorry for interruption. Is the screen visible, ma'am?
Oh, no, Madhu.
Yeah, I'll check it. Is it visible now?
You can meanwhile, yeah, it's visible now.
Yeah, thank you. You can proceed, ma'am.
Thank you. My voice is clear. Is my voice clear?
Yeah, your voice is clear, ma'am, but we have yeah, now it's clear. Now it's clear.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so thank you. So, today's topic, the history of English literature, the socio and political background. So, we all know that among the various countries of the world which have a hoary past and a rich culture to feel proud of, the language of Great Britain is now the language of the world, and it is the language of commerce, industry, and science. Above all, it is perhaps most profound in its literature, right from the time of King Alfred to our day. We have sound literary histories which offer us chronological accounts of literary creations spanning such a large period of 13 centuries. Literature and society are actually linked together. They are linked to each other in ever so many ways. A knowledge of one enhances an understanding of the other. So we all know that literature is a social establishment, and the social history of England is dazzlingly rich and variegated, full of rewards for an avid student of English literature. Times have changed. English studies do not mean the study of narrow confines of British history anymore. So horizons have broadened with the proliferation of newer and newer areas of study, widening the spectrum of literary knowledge. But still, a sound knowledge of socio-political and intellectual background of English history is of utmost necessity. So the story of Great Britain is highly inspiring and fascinating one for a student of literature. So it is necessary to first grasp the political, historical and social changes of the country before venturing forth to study its literature. So this is because literature is the product of a society. The changes and fluctuations in a society are clearly reflected in literature of its period. Similarly, the great writers and thinkers of a period have tremendous impact upon the society to which they belong. So thus, literature and society are inextricably linked together. The social history of any nation is an independent discipline, most useful for promoting literary scholarship. Stop the screen now. I finished the introduction and then we can share the screen. the social history of any nation is an independent discipline most useful for promoting literary scholarship. So it supplies with the knowledge of the past and glimpse into the future. The journey through the history of Great Britain from Anglo-Saxon times to the present is a fascinating one, and it is sure to give the student of English literature a sound background that is essential for the full appreciation of English literature. So it has been observed that the early history of Britain is essentially the history of invaders, the Celts, Romans, Anglo-Saxons and Romans. The Normans were a few of the more important conquerors of England. Each left their unique and indelible mark in English language and history. So the tapestry of modern English society and culture is woven with the fine threads of its various invaders. It is astonishing when we compare England's early history with its recent history. From being a weak country under constant foreign invasion, it grew into a superpower which had its colonies all over the world till the mid-20th century. As a result, English language of the people of Great Britain became an international language. So, how did such a small country manage to emerge from the shadow of its conquerors? How did it extend its political influence over more than half the world? So the answers to these questions form the incredible history of Great Britain. Let us move on to the slide, please. So, little is actually known about the original inhabitants of England, who are called Picts. They are of a low intellectual level. So, around 500 BC, streams of invaders known as Celts arrived on the shores of England. The Celts were made up of numerous tribes and invaded England in waves. So, the earliest to arrive were the Gaels, who invaded the western and northern parts of the country. So the Britons or the Britons came next and occupied most of the present day England and Wales. Participants, kindly mute your mic. Okay. So the name Britain actually was taken from this branch of the Celts. Actually, Celts were fierce fighters but lacked the political skill. Actually, Iron Age began after the Celts settled down in Britain. They worshipped nature. Their power was curtailed by Romans, the next invaders of the land. So, first Gaels, then Celts, then the Romans. We find the invaders, Romans. So, next slide, please. So, we all know that Romans had a great impact on Britain. So, in 55 BC, Julius Caesar made his expedition to Britain and learned that the land was fertile, but the people weak. So, they planned to plunder the wealth first, but looking at the weakness of the people, they decided to stay. Nearly for 300 years, England became a province of the vast Roman Empire, which had already Italy, Spain, Greece, and Asia Minor under their control. Next, please. They established forts, roads, and improved the lands. So Britain became one of the chief granaries of Europe. Christianity was introduced and many natives started learning Latin. Thus, Britons were civilized into an orderly community. But actually, Romans had to withdraw from Britain in order to protect themselves from numerous invaders. So Britons were forced to defend themselves from the fierce invaders. So by the middle of the 5th century, next slide please.
Sorry for the interruption, ma'am. One second.
Britain. Yes.
There is one message from participant that whether you can explain the previous slide because voice is breaking, it seems. Can you please explain the previous slide, ma'am?
This Roman slide? You want the Romans? Actually, Romans had a great impact on Britons, we can say that, because they were the people who made them civilized and orderly community. Because they actually, those people were nearly savage, like savage. So these people, Romans, they civilized the community. We find that Julius Caesar just came to Britain for an expedition. But he found the land fertile, but the people were weak. So they wanted to plunder, take away the wealth, but by looking at the weakness of the people, they decided to stay. And for nearly 300 years, we can find that England was the province of vast Roman Empire. And Roman Empire already had Italy, Spain, Greece, and Asia Minor under their control. So these Romans, they actually established many kinds of civilization in Britain. They built the forts, they improved the lands, made roads, and they made England or Britain the chief granary of Europe. So next, Christianity was introduced by the Romans into and many native people, that is Britain, started learning Latin. So thus the Romans made the Britons somewhat civilized, and they became an orderly community. Yeah, next please. Is it okay now? But we find that Romans could not stay for a long time because they were also invaded by numerous invaders. So they had to withdraw from the land of Britain. Actually, Britain were forced to defend themselves. They were actually protected by Romans in some manner, but now the Romans have withdrawn from the land, and these Britons had to face the invasions anymore. So by the middle of the 5th century, we find that Britain was invaded by the Germanic tribes. The most important of them were Jews, the Saxons, and the Angles. And the Angles, the race, which gave England its present name. We know that Angle Land, the English came from this term Angle Land, and it is English. So these invaders, they established 7 kingdoms called Heptarchy, which are Kent, Essex, Sussex, Wessex, Northumbria, East Anglia, and Mercia. And these kingdoms fought against each other for their supremacy. And King Egbert of Wessex won the supremacy. And he was supremacy of his kingdom was established, and he is considered to be the first king of England. Okay, next please. And we find that the Anglo-Saxon also had a great impact. More than the Romans, these people had more impact on the English people. And actually, they stamped out Christianity from England. And actually, these people, we know all know that English literature has had its beginnings from the sound of stories, and they usually often gathered around the fire to listen to the tales of battle. And these wandering minstrel people, soldiers, these people used to narrate tales of courage and endurance, which stirred the spirit of the listeners. So the most famous of these, we all know this, Bjorn. Next slide, please. We all know that it is Beowulf. Am I audible? Yeah, the most famous of these is Beowulf, a collection of pagan tales. Pagan people, they worshipped nature in many forms. So the collection of pagan tales and historical events containing more than 3,000 lines, the oldest surviving poem of the Teutonic people. Actually, the Gripionet team, they will be giving more details about these literature in their course. I just give only my minor introduction about the Beowulf. It is a collection of pagan tales. It consists of 3,000 lines, the oldest surviving text. So Beowulf gives us very accurate picture of the courageous Anglo-Saxons. And some other important poets include Cædmon, who lived during the 600s, and another one is Cynulf, and he was another poet of the Anglo-Saxon time. And they wrote in a fusion of paganism and Christianity in their poetry. So the fusion we can find there. Paganism as well as Christianity also has laid some trace in the land. Britons, actually, they were following it. So the Christianity also had some impact on the whole. Next slide, please. Yeah, we find that around 500s, Christianity was reintroduced to England for the second time. And a monk named Augustine, who was sent by Pope Gregory, came to England. He built the monastery at Canterbury and preached Christianity. So he was the first Archbishop of Canterbury, or the leader of the Church of England. So when this was going on, we find the attack of the Danes. So next invaders, the middle of the 9th century, during the 1800s, we find the Danes or the Vikings. They came from Denmark and Norway. Actually, they were seafaring people. They attacked and conquered the Anglo-Saxon kingdoms. So the territory over which Danes ruled was called Danelaw, because it was governed by the law of Danes. So the Danes' power could not last long. Alfred the great Anglo-Saxon king, he resisted. He fought against the Danish. He attacked. But after his death, there was again a relapse of this order. So once again, Danes invaded and they ruled it for some time. And again, order was restored by Alfred's grandson, Edward, who brought back England in 1042. So this Edward, he was called the Edward the Confessor, because he is important in the history of English literature because of his piety, and also he was known for building the Westminster Abbey. So it is an important place according to literature. Many of the poets and authors rest there. So it is a famous place, Westminster Abbey. So in next slide, please. So in 1066, we find the death of Edward, and we find that the Norman invaders from France, they conquered England in the famous Battle of Hastings. So William, Duke of Normandy, or he is popularly known as William the Conqueror, became the King of England. And he was responsible for establishing a strong central government. So he introduced the feudal system for distribution of lands. So this feudalism is nothing but the sharing, or lands where all the lands were owned by the king, and it was shared with the people called barons and knights. They had to pay rents, and also they have to render military service and pay feudal taxes. Okay, this is feudalism. It's a term which you can understand. It's a socio-political term. So during this time, we find that the rule, they were actually those people. Actually, William conducted a survey during this time to determine the details of the land in England and to fix tax. So that record of William's survey was known as Domesday Book. So that is also some important piece of information. It's called the Domesday Book. So actually, they ruled for nearly 4 centuries, and their language and the way of living of the people were very much influenced by these French rulers. And William died in 1087. His son William Rufus, who is also known as William II, ascended the throne. Then after him, his brother Henry the One. Then his grandson Henry the Two, who was only 2 years old, took up. But as he was only 2 years old, his uncle Stephen became the king. And then soon after the death of Stephen, Henry the Two became the king. Actually, he come from a family called Plantagenet family, because they used to wear a plant called genet in their caps. So his name, the name of the family, is called the Plantagenet family. So Henry the Two comes from this family. So these he was the one who restored the order, and he strengthened the kingship, and also along with this he claimed the rule of Scotland and Wales, which was part of England. So actually that was somewhat around like a conflict, and he was also known for the conflict with Thomas Becket. We all know about Thomas Becket because he is one of the famous characters in literature. So Thomas Becket, he was the Archbishop of Canterbury. This incident is very important in English literature because this becomes plot in many of the future literary pieces. So I'll give you the glimpse of the incident. It is due to the conflict. Actually, he fled to France. He was there for the Archbishop Thomas Becket. He was there for 6 years. Then he returned to England. Again, the conflict started. So he was killed by the king's man while he was saying his evening prayers. This shocked the Christian community. The king also felt sorry and he repented for his sin by allowing the faulty clergy in the future to get tried in ecclesiastical courts, this which continued till the Archbishop was given Canterbury Cathedral, which had the tomb attracted pilgrims from all parts of Europe. So the martyrdom of Thomas Becket has been commemorated in English literature by not less than 4 writers. You can find the writers here in the slide. Chaucer, in his masterpiece, The Canterbury Tales. Then the George Darley, an Irish dramatist. Then Alfred Tennyson have written drama about it. And the modern play, The Murder in the Cathedral by T.S. Eliot, is based on the tragic end of this great churchman. Okay. So, yes. So we find that Richard I, the son of Henry II, popularly known as the Lionheart, took part in the Third Crusades. Actually, crusades are important because they are military expeditions undertaken by European powers between the 11th and 14th century to recover the holy places that Jesus Christ had lived in his early life or earthly life. So King John, brother of Richard I, he was a poor ruler and had several enemies. So he again fought with the barons and the archbishop. So these people, they conquered and made him sign a document, which is another important milestone in the history of England. That is the Magna Carta, the Great Charter in 1215, which is actually the document which marked the beginning of the English Constitution. So this is important, very important milestone in the history. So Henry III, next, we find that, next slide please. Henry III, John's eldest son, built a church in the famous Westminster Abbey. So his name should also be remembered because I told you as Westminster Abbey is important. So that place actually, which was erected by Edward the Confessor, now a church was built by Henry III in there. And we find the arrival of some of the people called Dominican and Franciscan friars, who are called Black Friars and Grey Friars respectively because of the cloak or the color of dress they wear. So, and he was the first to summon the parliament in 1265. So this is another important milestone in the history of social history of England. So first to summon the parliament. And then we find Edward I, in 1295, he developed the parliament, which was created by his ancestor, by calling meetings of nobles, churchmen, knights, and few representatives of his town. So actually, historians refer this as the model parliament, and it's a pattern for the later parliaments. So another important milestone, political milestone, we find here. And during his reign, actually, Wales was brought under the control of English. So in 1301, he gave the title Prince of Wales to his son. Ever since, it has become a tradition to refer to all male heirs to the throne by that title. So we all know now, in the present day, we all know the male heirs of the throne of England, the royal family of England, as the Prince of Wales. So that was actually the title given to the male heir. So he tried to get throne of Scotland, but defeated by Robert Bruce. Then after his son, Edward II also tried, but was defeated. So the crown was given to Robert Bruce, the King of Scotland. Then after that, his son, Edward III, also brought in some conflict with the marriage of Isabella, the daughter of the French king, and claimed the throne of France. But but this led to another important milestone in the history of England, 100 years of war. So you can see 100 years of war from 13, it was between England and France. They never had a good relationship, and they interfered in each other's business. So for generations, the kings from the two rival dynasties fought for the throne of the largest kingdom, Western Europe. Next, please. Next, we find the...
Sorry for the interruption, ma'am.
Yes.
Some distortion in your audio. Can you please check, ma'am, with the audio?
Am I audible now?
Yes, your audio.
Am I audible now?
Some sound at the background.
But it is clear over here. It's nothing. Yes.
Okay.
Is it audible now?
Participants, is it audible for you now? You can put in your messages in chat box. Yes. Participants, kindly mute yourself. Only then the speaker's audio will be clear. Kindly mute yourself.
Yes, can I proceed?
Yes, ma'am, you can proceed.
So now we come to some of the literary milestones during the period. So as I told you, I'm not going to touch upon literary points in detail here. This will be actually done in the crash course by the people of GripYourNet team. So this is only, I'm just touching upon some of the milestones. We find that Geoffrey Chaucer, a great personality in literature, he was living, he lived during the Edward III's reign. And we find that his masterpiece, The Canterbury Tales, accurately capture the life and habits of people of his day. And some of the other poets were John Gower and William Langland. And we find that William Langland's Piers Plowman, like The Canterbury Tales, gives the glimpse, fascinating glimpse of English life during the 14th century. Next, as we are held up now in the pandemic, during that century also, we find the pandemic, the bubonic plague, known as the Black Death, which wiped out one-third of the population of England. Nearly one-third of the population of England was wiped out by this contagious disease, which was spread by fleas from the infected rats. So this was somewhat around an important, this is also an important, next please. Next we find some important milestones in religion, which was made by John Wycliffe. He was a pious priest actually. and he's called the morning star of Reformation, we all know that, because he questioned the authority of church. And his followers actually translated Bible into English in 1382, and they came to be known as the Lollards. So the Lollards, those were the followers of John Bible. And he became an influential dissident within the Roman Catholic priesthood during the 14th, important predecessor of Christianity, we know that, that is Protestants. So next is, we find the reign of Edward III. He was actually a lavish person, and he had a lavish court. He encouraged feasts and tournaments, and he actually, the age was influenced by chivalry, expeditions, military expeditions, chivalry, bravery, etc. So he influenced the stories by the stories of King Arthur and his round table, another important aspect in literature. So we find the King Arthur and his round table here. So next slide, please. Next we come to the kingdom of England with the Lancastrian and Yorkist kings, 1399 from 1485. They are also important because they gave an important event called the War of Roses. So what was their rivalry? We can see the Lancastrian kings were the descendants of the third son of Edward III. And so there were three kings of this dynasty, who were Henry IV, V, and VI. The Duke of York, another son of Edward III. So these two people were actually brothers, and their descendants, the rivalry between their descendants. And we find three kings of dynasty where Edward IV, Edward V. Yeah, is it audible now? Some of the participants say that they have some problem in audio. Is it audible? Am I clear now? Yeah, one second. Is it okay now? Yeah? Is it audible now?
Yes.
So we were talking, previous slide, please. So we were talking about the War of Roses. So actually this was between the two brother rivalries. So we find that these wars were actually fought with... these wars were actually fought between Lancastrians and Yorkists. So this name was actually derived from the badges, the white rose for Yorkists and the red rose for Lancastrians. So the name, the War of Roses. So it was a kind of a civil war. And the Lancastrian, and we find that Lancastrian had Henry Tudor, Henry the VII, won the throne defeating Richard the III. Hence we find the next dynasty's name as the Tudor period. Yeah. Shall I continue? Yeah. Tudor period. So these are some of the rulers during the period. We find a span of rulers from 1485 to 1603. So we starting from Henry the Seventh to Elizabeth the One. So we find all these people. So we will go into the slides, please. Next slide. So the Tudor period was actually defined as golden era in British history. It was the time of extravagance, music, and of course, it was the time of Shakespeare. So we all know that. And also queens. We also find some of the queens of England during this period. So it was the period which is named after the Tudor family that ruled in England and Wales from 1485 until the death of Elizabeth in 1603. So this is a remarkable period of Reformation and Renaissance. It gave peace and order. England emerged as Queen of Seas, and actually England passed from early medievalism to modern periods. So there was a transformation, we find. There is a transition in the civilization of the people. Next, please. So, Henry the Seventh was the King of England, and he was also the Lord of Ireland, and he was the first monarch of the House of Tudor. Yeah, next slide, please. Can you share the next slide? Yeah. Is it audible? Yeah. Okay. So we find the first monarch to be family of from the family of England, and he was the monarch, first monarch of the House of Tudor. And actually, previous slide, please. Excuse me, give me a moment. Let me check my earphone.
Sorry for the interruption. Kindly wait. There is some sound that is disturbing in the background. We are working on it. Participants, kindly wait.
Yeah. Is it audible now? Madhu, is it audible now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, now it's clear.
Okay, thank you.
Is it clear now?
Okay, let me continue.
Yes, now it is clear.
Okay, yes,
thank
yes.
you.
Thank you.
Continue. Okay. Am I going fast or is the space enough for the participants? Answer?
No, it is perfect. Okay, it is perfect.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Okay, actually we were looking into the period of Henry the Seventh. Actually, previous slide, Madhu.
Yes. Is this okay?
Yeah. So starting from Henry the previous slide. We're talking about Henry the Seventh, the first monarch of the House of Tudor. Yeah, actually he is now it's okay. He is credited with a number of administrative, economic, and diplomatic initiatives. So he was called the Fat King also, and he was the one who presided over the beginnings of the English Renaissance and Reformation. English Reformation, the two important movements in the history of English literature.
Ma'am, sorry for interruption.
Yeah.
Can you be a bit slower?
Of course.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So we find that it was the English Renaissance and the Reformation. Actually, these two movements, we all know about these two great movements which influenced greatly the literature, English literature. So very important to know about the English Renaissance and Reformation. We will have a brief idea about that in the future coming slides. So Henry the VIII next became the head of the Church of England, and he passed on the Act of Supremacy by the Reformation Parliament. He headed that, and in 1534 we find that. Next, please. So next we find Edward the Sixth, who was in first England's first monarch to be raised as a Protestant. This period was actually marked by economic problems, social unrest, and many problems in religion also. So it was not a great period according to the history of English people. So next we find Mary the One, the Queen. She's also called Mary Tudor, and she actually reigned from 1553 until her death. And she vigorously, she had an attempt to reverse the English Reformation. That is from Roman Catholicism, England moved towards Protestantism. She wanted to reverse that. So she was working on that, and we find that the Reformation, during which her father started, Henry the Eighth, who started Reformation, she actually made several attempts to reformed that. So that was found during her period. Next we find Elizabeth. We all know about the Elizabethan age, which was a great age, the golden age of literature, we say. So that was the period actually, that was a golden age for in the history of England also. She is called Virgin Queen, and she was the last of the five monarchs from the House of Tudor. So here each of the dynasties in England was named after the their families. So we find that she was the last of the five monarchs who ruled the king England under the Tudor kingdom. So and during her period, it was tremendous progress, as we saw that there was king England emerged as the queen of seas, and there were expedition, maritime exploration, invention, scientific inventions, and whatnot. It was flourishing. We all know that literature. It flourished during this period of Elizabethan age. Yeah. Next. So. So we find that the beginning of the Tudor dynasty, it coincided with the first dissemination of printed matter. So the first advent, the scientific advent, we can say that according to literature can be the printing press, which was set up by William Caxton in 1476. So it was established. It was only 9 years before the beginning of Henry the Seventh's reign. So Caxton's achievement encouraged writing of all kinds, and it influenced the standardization of the English language. So we find the printing press marks the beginning of the printed material of literature. So people started reading a lot. So next we find that the stronger political relationship with the continent were also developed, and there was there was an increasing exposure of England towards Renaissance culture. We all know that what is Renaissance. Renaissance is a many-sided movement. It's a complex movement towards art, literature, and many other fields. So Walter Pater, according to Walter Pater, we find that it is he is right in calling Renaissance as the complex and many-sided movement, or in the largest sense we can say Europe. This period was actually the process of transition of Europe from medieval to modern order. So that were a lot of changes we can find during that time. Next is the Reformation and Counter-Reformation, and this also we find a great importance in the history of England. So this is the Catholic Reformation we finally we generally refer to, and actually the reform that began in the Middle Ages, it continued throughout the Renaissance. And the Counter Reformation means the steps the Catholic Church took to oppose the growth of Protestantism. So people started gliding towards Protestantism. So from Roman Catholicism. So the Counter-Reformation is the fact that they were reversing again. Then again, they were going towards the Roman Catholicism. So this is what we come under to know about Reformation and Counter-Reformation. Then we find a lot of activities of literature of the Elizabethan, which reflected a new nationalism, which expressed itself in the work of the chronicles, historians, and translators. And even in political and religious sections, we find there were a lot of genres. A myriad of new genre themes and ideas grew in them. So we find the most importantly, we find the Italian poetic forms, sonnet, the models which form the models for English poets like Sir Thomas Wyatt and Henry Howard, the Earl of Surrey. And we find that the seminal influence was Tolstoy's Miscellany in 1557, very much important as far as literature is concerned, which marks the milestone. Was the first and most popular of many collections of the experimental poetry. And these were actually by different anonymous people. It had a great lot of impact. So, but the common goal of all these poets was to make English flexible in poetic instrument as Italian form, in the Italian forms. So we next important poet, next slide. So next we come to know about Edmund Spenser, another important poet during this period. And we find Shakespeare, Michael Drayton, Samuel Daniel, Sidney, Sir Walter Raleigh, all these people. And we all know that Edmund Spenser's The Fairy Queen, which was published in 1596, had a tremendous impact. And it is his unfinished epic poem. And it is actually the treasure house of romance, allegory, adventure, Neoplatonic ideas, patriotism, and Protestant morality. So it presented a variety of literary styles we find here. So next is the important Renaissance man we can say is Sir Philip Sidney, the scholar, poet. He's a critic, he's a courtier, a diplomat, and a soldier. He lived very short, who died at the age of 32. But his best poetry, we can see the sonnet sequence Astrophel and Stella, which was published in 1591, and his Defense of Poesy is among the most important works of literary criticism in the tradition. Even today, at today's context, we talk about this literary critical work. So next we find many others in historical era when poetic talents were highly valued. There were skilled poets. So the important sonneteers, we can say it is Spenser, Shakespeare, many others, as I call the Samuel Daniel, Sidney, all of them. And actually, Sir Walter Raleigh, to talk about Sir Walter Raleigh, he's a poet and he's also a historian, courtier, and an explorer who wrote so many poetries. Then we find the early Tudor drama, which owed much to the both medieval morality plays and classical models. We find the Ralph Doister by Nicholas Udall and Gammer Gurton's Needle, being the first English comedies, combining elements of classical Roman comedy with the native burlesque comedies. Yeah. So in the late 16th and 17th centuries, drama flourished in England as never before. And it's the age with the work of the university wits, the important people in literature. They are, have you mentioned them? John Lilly, Green, Lodge, Nash, Kidd, Marlowe. Of course, Marlowe, known for his blank verse and many of his predecessor of Shakespeare, an important personality in literature. Next, we come to the, of course, the great literarian William Shakespeare. Actually, he's the one who fulfilled, he was universally acclaimed in nature. So next, which you have to, as British literature is given more weightage in net, these ideas will be shared by the people of the coaching center. They will be giving you more ideas on these topics. This is very important as far as the net point of view is concerned now. So next we come to the Stuart period. So again, the name, why the name was given. After the death of Queen Elizabeth, there was no legitimate heir. We all know that she was a virgin queen. She never married. So her heir was King James of Scotland. And he came to the throne and he had the lineage of the House of Stuart. So thus marking the beginning of the Stuart period from 1603 to 1714. And here also we find so many important events marking the history. So it witnessed intense religious and political conflicts, so which shifted from the monarchy to parliament. We know about the civil war, Oliver Cromwell, which we'll be talking about in the later slides. So it was a time which was shifted from monarchy to parliament. So that you have to remember when it is concerned about the Stuart age. So the Stuart period was between 1603 and 1714. It witnessed some of the monumentally changeable times in British history. Some of those changes were civil war, rebellion, the beheading of the king, plague outbreaks, the Great Fire of London. So all these important political events you can mark. So to know, we have to know about all these things as a student of literature. So successful foreign, and also there was a successful foreign invasion. So actually, there were seven Stuart monarchs. The names are given here: James the Sixth, Charles the One, Charles the Two, James Two and Seven, and William the Third and Second, and Mary and Anne. So these, and also we find two Lord Protectors. Actually, I told you that it was a shift from monarchy to Parliament. We find a Lord Protector called Oliver Cromwell and his son Richard. So these are, see, these are some of the rulers of this period. So we find these people. Yeah, next. So we find this end of Tudors due to the death of Elizabeth without a heir. We find that it signaled the end of the Tudor dynasty, and crown passes to her closest relative. As we saw that it is James I. So James I, this king, he called himself the King of Great Britain. But though it was not approved by the House of Commons, that is the Parliament, it is not approved, but he gave the name for himself as the King of Great Britain. Great Britain means the lands of Scotland, Ireland, Wales, everything coming together. It forms the Kingdom of Great Britain. So he imagined that he has conquered everything, and he has his control, under his control. So he called himself the King of Great Britain. And he was obsessed with actually witchcraft. And he has written a book called Demonologue, How to Deal with Witches. And he actually, this is the book which inspired Shakespeare's Macbeth. Macbeth, we know that there are three witches in the beginning of the play, and throughout the play, we have the impact of the witches. So the Shakespeare's Macbeth was inspired by this particular work. So this is an important step you can note down for your NET exam. Then we find the gunpowder plot, which he joins with some people, and he made a gunpowder plot. Then he joins English and Scottish flags to create the Union flag. We call it the Union Jack flag now. So it's the Union flag. As I told you, he was imagining that he was the King of Great Britain. That is all the plans, and he was only able to join English and Scottish flags together. And actually, he is the person who authorized a new translation of Bible, the King James Bible, which came to be called the King James Bible. And he was a major influence on English literature. As I told you, there were many translations, so he was encouraging translations, and that's why he was a major influence on English literature language, and for centuries to come. So people were influenced by this particular period. And actually, the divine rights of kings. So it's an important thought. He has a major influence on language, literature, and thought. So he was important to know in the point of view of the history of England. Next, we come to know about Charles the One. Yeah, next slide. He ruled England from 1625 to 1649, and we find that it was cruelty to Protestants in Scotland and England. So these people were cruelly treated, and there were riots in Scotland, the civil war, 1642 to 1649, you find the civil war, then Oliver and Cromwell and the Protestant versus Charles the One, all these people, they were fighting against each other, and then Puritan roundheads versus Royalist cavaliers. So these are some of the people who are engaged in the civil war. Finally, what happened? Charles I loses his head. He was beheaded. So he was the first ever monarch to undergo a cruel punishment. So he was beheaded. Next, please. So next we find the Commonwealth era. and there was a long parliament. Actually, Charles thought that there was no necessity of parliament because as a king he has all the rights claim whatever he wants. So he never thought about the parliament and never gave importance to parliament. But parliament and the people like keep on fighting. That was the cause of the civil war. And we find that there was a long parliament. Yeah. Is there any problem in moving the slides? Yes.
No, ma'am.
Is it okay now?
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, now it's I can see the slide. Yeah. Okay. So we find that there is a long parliament just to pass the financial bills. He thought that it is that. So he named it long parliament as the title was time consuming. So we find it is long parliament. Then we find the Commonwealth era, which is otherwise known as interregnum. So this is an important word. All the literarians have to keep in mind the interregnum. So we find so many literature during this period. So we find, so as literary personalities, we have to keep remembering these eras and these names, these terms. So next we find again the restoration of monarchy by Charles II, we find the restoration of monarchy. And actually he was popularly known as the Merry Monarch. Actually he was pleasure loving and he took a small interest in the affairs of the state. So he was a merry monarch. He's a very poor character. He devoted to pleasure, self-serving and scandalous. He was not a king of a good kind. So we find that. And also next important event to mark this age is the theatres reopened, because during the plague and the great fire of London, the theatres, and also due to Oliver Cromwell, who was much interested in Puritanism, he closed the theatres. So we find the theatres were opened during this period. So we find the restoration comedy became a recognizable genre. So we find the restoration comedy becoming the recognizable genre in literature. And actually theater licenses were granted by Charles, and which actually permitted the women to play female roles on the stage. Another important landmark as far as literature is concerned and also theater is concerned. So all these some of these events we find from the diary of Samuel Pepys. So he's an important diarist. When we talk about diarist, we talk about Samuel Pepys. He chronicles the two disastrous events during the reign of Charles II. So what are the two important disastrous events? It is the great plague of London in 1665. Around 1 lakh people died in this great fire plague. And also next we find that the great fire of London, which is in 1666. So these are two disastrous events we can find. So much of the London was destroyed during this period. And we also find the St. Paul's Cathedral, which had suffered under great fire, was also rebuilt shortly after the fire. Yeah, next please. So we find the rule of James II. No much of the events we can find during this period. So I have just shortened to the names. So he was an evolved Catholic ruler. He came back to Catholicism. Then we find the Glorious Revolution, a revolution without a bloodshed, because King William and Mary, they were invited from Scotland and to rule England. So it was united and the realm become one. So under that the glory, that's why it's called the Glorious Revolution. And they were without any support, they became the king and queen of England. So next we find Queen Anne's age, which is also very important because we all are coffee lovers, and we know that the history of coffee houses in England began during this period. So coffee houses, Queen Anne's coffee houses, we all are familiar about. So we find that during her she was actually the last of the Stuarts. So as I told you, the family names marked the dynasties, and she was the last monarch of the Stuarts. Then we find that the Acts of Union, England and Scotland become one, and realm Great Britain. Her father, which her father was trying, she got it done, and in 1707 it becomes the realm of Great Britain now. So some of the literary figures we find during this period are and some of the eminent literary figures and some socio-political enterprises which I have marked here are Francis Bacon, John Donne, Milton, Ben Jonson, John Dryden, and we find these terms in literature: Jacobean, Caroline Age, then Interregnum, Restoration Age, Enlightenment Age, all come under this. And some of other important topics include Puritanism, there was colonial expansion, East India Company coming to India, especially India and many other countries. So colonial expansion was there. Then we find coffee houses. As I told you, coffee houses was also some of the important terms which you have to remember during the Stuart age. Yeah, next, please. So next, we come to the Hanoverian England. So next dynasty from 1714 to 1901. So actually Queen Anne died in 1714 without leaving any heir, because all her children died in infancy. She had some around 13 to 14 children, which of them all died during their infancy due to pneumonia, plague, etc. So many kinds of diseases, they all died in their infancy, and she was left without a heir when she died. So Sophia, the Electress of Hanover, the place in England, she was actually invited, the daughter of James I, she was deputed as the queen after her. But even when Queen Anne died, she was under deputation, but when Queen Anne died, even Sophia, she also died. So she was not alive during that period. So her son George became the king. So now we also come to understand of the term the Georgian era here, because the term Georges, so many Georges ruled England from now on. We find that the Georgian era began. So we can see the Hanoverian kings, George the 1, the 2, the 3, the 4, and we find William the 4 and Queen Victoria. So these are some of the monarchs who ruled during the Hanoverian England. So next, please. Some of the political important political event, because it was the age of so many kind of revolutions, and we find so many kind of socio-political enterprises during this period, and they also have so much of impact in the literature, English literature. So these events have to be clearly studied in detail. Each and every detail should be known to the student of literature. So we find that the king, being a foreigner, he does not know the language. He does not have the kind of what we can say a hold in the parliament. So the parliament was more powerful, and the term prime minister, which became known from that age. So we find that. Before that, I will talk about the literary personalities during this period. We find the authors like Jonathan Swift, Alexander Pope, Dr. Johnson's dictionary. We have to talk about the dictionary, which is very important in English language. Then Oliver Goldsmith, and it spanned over the Romantic poets' age. Then we find the prose writers. All these people are some of the great literary personalities whom will be held in detail by the course. In the course, you can see. So I'm talking about the socio-political enterprises, which is more important in my talk. So here we find the king being the foreigner. Actually, the parliament was powerful, when we find the term prime minister, of which Robert Walpole became the prime minister. Actually, he was not so, efficient, but that name was there. And we find in 1721, the prime ministership, the term prime ministership came to England. So next we find the War of American Independence, then we find the French Revolution, Napoleonic Wars, the Union of Great Britain and Ireland. Previously, we find that Great Britain and Scotland were made into one realm, and now there was an Union of Ireland, so it becomes the Union Jack now. So these are some of the important political events we can find during this time. Yeah, next, please. Okay, now we come to the House of Windsor. from 1901 to the present day. So we find that there are a lot of changes that were happening during this period. Yeah, is there any problem? Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am, you can continue.
Okay, we find the house of Windsor. Okay, from 1901. Why this name? We have to see. So the House of Windsor actually came into being in 1917, and when the name was adopted by the British royal family's official name, and it was the proclamation by King George V, because he does not want to remember the German sentiments. Because of this anti-German sentiment, he wanted to change his own historic name, that is Saxe-Coburg-Gotha. He changed into English Windsor. It was actually the castle in which they lived is called the Windsor Castle. So they call it the House of Windsor. So it became anti-German, and during the World War I, we know about the World Wars and its impact, and the rule of Hitler, etc. We all know about that. So people were very much, English were offended during that time, and actually he wanted to come out of those things. So he shifted the name of the dynasty into the House of Windsor. So now it remains the family name of the current royal family. Now it's called the House of Windsor. Okay, next please. So events that shook the world and literature. Okay, we have the Holocaust literature, is from the World Wars. So we find that the World Wars, actually it is abbreviated as WW1, and it is also known as the First World War, which is called the Great War, which was also a global war which lasted from around 28 July to 1914 to 1918. So almost for 4 years we find the World War One, which have a great impact on the people, their habitats, then the way of living, everything shattered. People found shocked, and also this impact was, we can find this impact in the literature also. There is so many kind of the realism, the beauty and the romanticism which was found in literature was soon found to have shaken by the event of World War. So next important event is World War II, which is also abbreviated as WW2, also known as the Second World War, and this is also a global war which lasted from 39 to 45. So we also find here also the people were shattered by these wars. There were a lot of devastation. People were frustrated, and we find the irritation of the people in most of the literature also. Yeah, next please. So another important thing was the Cold War. We have to talk about that also during this period. So the Cold War, which was a period of geopolitical tension between Soviet Union and the United States, it was from 1947 to 1991. It was in the previous slide, I hope. So the Cold War was also an important thing. So these wars, when we talk about wars, we know that how it might be devastating. So the impact was found in the people also. Not only people, everything, all walks of life, in everything you can find the impact of these wars. So we find the literature and everything coming in under the influence of these wars. So now we come to the 60s, 1960s of the British history, actually the age of dynamic optimism. Okay, which is called the age of dynamic means something very much fast moving. That's what we call dynamic. So the the society started changing, that is, there is a lot of momentum we find here. So optimism, optimistic momentum we can see, optimistic dynamic movement we can see here. So it is from 1960s. This decade is actually refers to the years from the beginning of 1960 to 1969. These years are which mark the 1960s. Actually, it is known as the swinging 60s because the important term we have to remember, the swinging 60s, because it was associated with the birth of British pop music and fashion. We all know that we are affected by English fashion. All the people of the world around, people around the world are affected. So the music also influenced music lovers. We all know that, and we are very much inclined towards the Britain music also. So we find that. So it was that was, it's called swinging, swinging in the sense it was there. So we find that there is a kind of a beginning of this British pop music and fashion. So next important event is that we find the first space in man in space, that is in 1969. Then first human to walk on moon. All these people, all these things we find in this particular, in this, as far as scientific development is concerned, we find all these happenings. Then of course television and computers, which have actually shaken, or what we can say, influenced greatly the life of the people, came into existence during this period. So television as well as computers, and as the host Madhubala previously said during the introduction, she told that only because of the computers and the online teaching, we are able to come back to our positions now. Though we are all being stuck in our homes, this important landmark is possible only through the advent of this computer and technology. Though myself, my personal opinion is that I'm not very much happy about the situation, but still we are all united, we feel. Though secluded, though we are alone, we are being getting united through, at least through education, we are getting united. So advent of this television and the computers, television, we all know that we as kids and even now as the adults, everyone, they are addicted towards these two great instruments of science and technology. So when it comes to literature, we have some of the important terms we have to remember. The kitchen sink drama literature, we have a lot of the dramas. These are some of the dynamism we find during the 60s. Next slide, please. Yeah, next we come to our 70s. 70s is called the decade of disillusionment because of the Vietnam War. And actually, when there is war, there is disillusionment. We find that how the world wars have affected literature, world in general. In 70s also, we find the same kind of devastation due to this Vietnam War. People were affected and many of the people got displaced, uprooted, and the kind of the terms which we have now, alienation, isolation, many of these terms which came into existence, we can say that people started feeling all these abstract things in their life. So it is actually the decade of disillusionment we can find here due to the Vietnam War. So the modernism, after that we find this postmodernism. Literature, we find that there are postmodernistic literature, criticism, etc. We have a lot of things when it is concerned, when literature is concerned about these things. And again, the 80s. 80s, we find the incredible advances in communication and information technologies. Again, now we are in the age of information communication technologies. So there were quite a lot of advances in this we can find. So we find, talk about the trade unionism. So very much very important in the history of England. So it is a very important in the sense that people start the industrial. When we talk about the revolutions, there were which were during the Stuart age, there were French Revolution, Agrarian Revolution, Industrial Revolution. We find all these things during, and with all the advent of these industries, people wanted to secure their position. As we all know that during all these periods, people were given low wages and they were allowed to work for long hours, but they were given very low wages. When you actually find the Charlie Chaplin movies, you can have a very good glimpse of all the practices. Actually, he was the very good personality who mocked so many social problems during of that age. So we find the this union problem, the people, the industrial revolution which affected the human community in general, we can see in all those we can have a glimpse. Though it is comical in nature, it has a very great and grim truth to teach us. So we find that, so trade unionism, which was in 1820s, we find that people who are given low wages and made to work for long hours, they fought, came together and they formed some kind of unionism. And these people, these unions, they actually collected some money from the people, a small amount of money, and they used to fight for their rights and everything. We can find all these things in the trade unionism factor. And the people, because of that, now also we have so many unions, you can see, to protect our rights. When we have any problem, people started complaining it to unions, and these unions, they help, which is, help us in many ways to come out of some of the drastic problems we face. Next important milestone, because today's England, it talks about today's England, which is the origin and growth of the political parties. Actually, as I told you, the parliament was there the long before, but still we find that there were always the supporters of king and the supporters of the parliament. So the royalists, they were also called the Tories or the conservatives now, they were actually the support of the monarchy, the kingdom. King. And next we find the roundheads or the Whigs and the Liberal Party, who are the supporters of the parliament. We find those people. So always they support always the parliament. So this was that was the time when we talk about the Lord Protector Oliver Cromwell. Actually, he was standing, he was the Civil War during those time, and which was actually, you can when you read Adventures of a Shilling by Addison Steele, you can understand the background of the actually the Civil War, which was during the period of Charles and Oliver, and Oliver Cromwell, how the shilling suffered in the hands of a very good literary piece, a very interesting part of literature, we can say. How imaginary it is, how important, and how we can see that how people, how he has given life to a shilling, and it talks about the whole history of that period. So as we say, the literature always reflects the meaning in that particular prose piece. So growth of political parties, because now it's the age of political influence. In whatever part of the world we take, it is the politics, a great institution, we can call. So they have influence on all walks of life. So it started to origin and have its growth now as the conservatives and the liberal parties. We have the terms now, and before that it was royalists and then Tories and then conservatives, which who were the supporters of the king, and now the roundheads or the Whigs or the Liberal Party, who are the supporters of the parliament. Yeah, next please. Yeah, before moving into the 90s, excuse me, let me have a little amount of water please. So, 90s, again, many of us here are 90s kids. We all know that what happened during this time, and the 90s, we find giant leaps in the field of information and technology. And first of all, the devastation which marked it was the Gulf War, which was also devastating. And we all know about that. When we are kids, we used to stick glued to the TV and we find the news, what happened during the Gulf War, how we are now sitting glued to the TV to know about this coronavirus and all these pandemic and stuff going on. So we used to sit glued to the TV during those Gulf War times in 1990. And of course, the great important thing in our millennium, that is the World Wide Web, which came into being during the 90s. So we were all connected through something imaginary called the World Wide Web. So now it has different names. We say cloud computing. We are all connected somewhere and somewhere around. And there were email, mobile phones. So we can imagine, we are all experiencing it. We know about all these things a lot. So these things, how they have impacted positively and negatively our lives. So these are some of the times you can find here. So you can see the advent of these World Wide Web, mail. So communication, the technology of communication in the mouse click, in one wink of a second or in a fraction of a second, we are all connected together. So all these things were possible only through these things, I hope. So World Wide Web, email and mobile phones, they are connecting us. And one important idea about 1992 is recognized as the year of woman. So feminism, when we talk about literary genres, we have an important thing called feminism in our literature. And we can say that now feminism had its own fields, and it is very important for us to know about it. And there are different branches, ecofeminism, and which are very much related to this gynocriticism, and many the literature people, women who have started coming out of their nutshell, and they are flying with what we can say, flying colors. They are coming out with flying colors. So this recognition we have got as a woman, of course, I feel that there are any male members, I'm not offending them. Even we are given equality, we are being treated equal in this society, though there are so many problems which are what we can say erodating our being, but still people, we strive, we fight to come up, and we have all these kind of things which is possible only for this only because of the recognition which we are given. So in 1992 was wholly devoted for this recognition, which is recognized as the year for women. And we all know that the mesmerizing J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter series, the films, the magic realism, the journey of magic realism, though we have so much of kind of literature starting from Tolkien to Lord of the Rings, we have so many kind of things in literature, but still J.K. Rowling as a woman who started as a scrap, from the scrap she achieved greatness. And the Harry Potter series, of course, I am very much mesmerized by the series, and of course I am a great fan of J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter series. So we all are, I think. I hope you are all are. We have that kind of what we can say, always towards, and even to the mythology, which my topic, which I have chosen for my PhD, is also have its great impact, because of we grew up by learning. Listening to stories from all these mythologies, and of course we are all mesmerized by this. So always literature, we find the kind of thing which the literature, it has a great impact on our lives. So that's why I have a great flair for literature, and everyone of us have, I hope. So we have this kind of a thing. So J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter series had a great impact on the society. With this we come to the next slide, please. Yes, I'm audible. the 21st century, the new millennium. During 1999, when the clock struck 12, we entered into the new millennium, and we were all having different kinds of hopes, and it is a kind of a thing we all experienced. As I told you, many of us are the 90s kids here. We might have experienced this particular situation, the new millennium, the word new millennium, 2K, all these kinds of words, and we have so many kinds of what we can say. Things which gave us hope also, but the same thing, there was a kind of negative things which were also coming into being, the terrorism which is at its height during this time. We find the Twin Tower attacks, then so many kinds of ISIS communities affecting the people, and many of these things we find as an act of terrorism. Not only terrorism was against the people, it was also, even now we find it against, as I was talking about women are also made into subjected into constant attacks. So terrorism in all forms we are experiencing, but still there is a hope. We are all coming back to our lives, and we are having a great hope for the future. And another important thing which is social change, we can say, is the global warming due to this climatic change, and we are all experiencing it throughout the world. We are experiencing it, and we find it. So we can experience it and everything, as we know that it is not the same weather conditions which we experience now as we had in our childhood. So there is a drastic change. I always used to talk in my class that when we were kids, this place which we call Kutralam, it is full of greenery, and we always have this kind of seasonal rains and everything. But now we have the entirely a different kind of situation. We could not enjoy, we cannot experience that kind, because of this because of the concrete forests, because of the deforestation of the trees, and we have these concrete forest buildings all over. There is a lot of global warming and vehicles pollution. All these terms come into existence. These terms we have to remember: pollution, all kinds of pollution we have. So there is a great concept of global warming and climate change, and we can see these things impacting literature also. We have a particular realm of literature called green literature and ecofeminism, which talk about the ecology as well as feminism putting together. So all these things have great impact on literature also. So as I said, we all know that literature affects society, reflection of society, mirror of society, whatever it is. We find that all these things have great impact on literature. So we have great realms of literature like this. So people are constantly studying nature. With nature was worshipped by literarians, by the romantics and all. We know about the American poets, American writers, Robert Frost, Henry Thoreau, and everyone, they worshipped nature. They saw divinity in nature, and we all have that important idea in our mind, and literarians always have that in our mind, and these people, they support, they protect the world through their writings. There are many writers, and I would just definitely talk about the Indian writing during this period, which have a great marking, because starting right from Raja Rao, R.K. Narayan, and all the women writers whom we have now, they all are part of English society as well as the Indian society. We talk about diaspora, everything. So even there are certain problems like isolation, uprootedness, and they talk about the diaspora, where they were uprooted from one place to they land in another place, and the problems they face over there. So it's a kind of an interaction we have through literature now. So though the global warming and the climatic changes and the changes in the society, they affect us, but still they have some advancements also. Okay, now we have the Internet of Things. So as we all know that, I think I have talked about that a lot. So IoT, we say that. So it is much more clear through we are connected during this time. we have a lot of connection, and we have what we can say, this is created a network, our home, we have created a network through network in homes and network vehicles, GPS, where you are, we can understand where we are and the people, where they are held up, etc. We can, so the internet has helped a lot, and it has also changed the way people look at literature. So we have lot of things, and reading, where we say that this is not the age of reading, people still read. We can find that people still read, that a lot of research that is going on which help, which is being helped by this technology, this internet, and also many other technology which help us to do our research and many other kind of things. Though it is a bit against nature, but still we are all glued to this internet, and we have a lot of things coming into existence. So Britain saw a great ideas where from 60s to 90s and 21st century, we find these people, these great people of Great Britain, actually they marked many starting point, and then they marked many landmarks and milestones in the history of the world, not only as history of Britain. They also have some idea, they gave us a lot to the world, the advent of locomotive and transport, communication, postal communication, many things they were, it was given by. So these ages we can find, throughout the ages we can find, only because of these people, these foreign invasions and foreign ideas, we have the modern life has become unbelievably convenient, I hope. So though there are certain negative, as we have all pros as well as cons in all the areas, this modern life has been unbelievably convenient now because of these things, which was actually the advent of the people who took it forward, like people like Bill Gates, etc., who have this computer, and Mark Zuckerberg, and the social media networks and everything. So communication was possible, and this has a great impact on the history of England and how they are connected, and the people, they have a lot of givings to the world. So this all throughout these all things happenings mark the history of the great country. So as I told you that it was weak once, it was invaded, it was under constant invasion, but now it has emerged as a superpower only because of these advents, starting from printing press to today's computers, we have the technology development. So I believe this modern life is actually unbelievably convenient because of these changes. Thank you. Yes, Madhu?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much for this informative session. Thank you so much, ma'am. We thank you on behalf of GripYourNet and the participants. I hope this lecture was very much useful for all the participants. So now let us move on to the session of discussion. Participants, kindly wait. I'll change the slide.
About the lecture, they can kindly proceed, and also I'm ready to take up that. You can give in the chat box, or you can take up my mail ID so that I can also have some kind of discussions with you. I can mail you whatever you need.
Yes, we can have the discussion session where you can post your questions in the chat box. And
voice is not audible, Madhu.
Yeah, now is it audible now, ma'am?
Yeah, it's there is a glitch, I hope. Okay, yeah.
Yes, so now we'll move on to discuss on the NET exam preparation, and then we'll have the discussion on this presentation at last. So where you can post your questions in chat box, and ma'am will answer your questions, and you can also post your questions regarding the session on NET preparation now.
is my screen visible for
you? We are going to see how to prepare for NET and why now we are having this session on British literature. So basically, when we see the syllabus of NET exam, the first four units are genre based, in which we can see drama, poetry, fiction and non-fiction, in which comprises of all literatures, that is British literature, American literature, Indian literature, and everything comes under this. So it is sort of vast to complete and complete when we start our preparation. So basically, when we see this, every NET aspirant is afraid of this first four units, because it is very vast and we cannot cover within the period. Even myself and Swati was feeling the same when we were the beginner. And this portion is very, very important, where you will be getting around 30-40% of the questions from British literature. So that is why we have chosen British literature for the upcoming course series. So in this course series, So basically, NET exam is for eligibility, is just an eligibility test to see the eligibility of the aspirants who aspire to become a professor and who aspire to become a research scholar. So our aim should be always at high, where you should aim for JRF. So people who are applying for NET, please apply for both, that is NET and JRF. So when we apply for it, we keep our aim high. So we can prepare accordingly. First, we have to know how to prioritize the subject, and then we have to learn. So here, first, we should take British literature, because from British literature, you will be getting around 30 to 40% of questions in paper two. And mostly it will be, you can see around 6 to 7 questions.
Is it audible now? Am I audible to everyone? Yes. So when you are preparing for NET, you have to sort out the syllabus first. First, you have to take paper one and paper two and sort out what are the syllabus, and then prioritize the subject which you want to cover first. That comes when you analyze the question paper and everything. So here in this crash course, we analyze question paper, and we have analyzed question paper, and we are putting up our courses according to that. So first we had a course on theory and criticism, where we get around 20 to 30 questions from theory and criticism together, and then we moved on to teaching and research aptitude, where we are getting 10 to 12 questions in paper one and also 10 to 15 questions from paper two. So when we are planning according to this and making our preparation, it will be very, very easy for you to cover the portion. So basically, we have to be very clear that we should not be afraid of this exam. We all can clear, because only when you have confidence in you. So we basically help people here as a tipster in instilling confidence in you. So I'll explain this in detail later. Is my slide visible to everyone? Okay.
So in this crash course, we are having a crash course for 1 month. This crash course series on British literature, that is from 10th of July to 9th of August. So in this, we are covering around... So in this, we are covering from July 10th to 14th, we will be covering on early literature of age of early literature to age of revival. And then from July 16th to 20th, we will be concentrating on Elizabeth to restoration age. And then from 26th to 30th will be on Enlightenment to Victorian era. And then from August 5 to 9, you will be having modern and postmodern era. So why we have given 5 days for 5 days each for all these courses is we will cover a sort of every 4 units that we saw before in this syllabus, that is poetry, drama, fiction, and nonfiction. We will cover all these four under these four courses. In each age, you will be looking into important works, authors, and you will be getting materials also. So what we do in these 5 days is, yes. So what we do in this five days, basically in every crash course is we give online classes daily. So that will be around 2 to 3 hours. And then you will be receiving the notes for that day so that you can prepare for prepare with that notes on that day till night. And then the next day you will be having the next day's class. And after that evening, you will be given the test for the previous day's class, where you will be given all the notes, and you have the ample time to prepare for the next day's test. So this quiz that we give you daily is to make you study and you can also make yourself, sorry for the interruption because participants are leaving and they are joining in between. Sorry for the interruption. So this quick notes that we give will be very, very helpful for you to go through, and you can have a revision of that class that you have attended on that day. And the next day you can have the quiz for that, which you can comprehend yourself. You can find your own comprehensiveness. So then the next day we will discuss the previous day's quiz paper on how to handle the paper and how to approach the question and how to apply the knowledge that you have gained in the previous day's class on the test. So we actually make our students to not only listen to lecture, but also we make them as a tipster to study and then revise and then again have a test continuously. So these 5 days you will be having continuous tests and also assignments. So this assignment is basically, we will not only give you notes, we also give assignments. This is basically because that we believe that when we ourselves sit and study for ourselves and make a note, that will really help a lot. Apart from classes, you also should work on yourself. So whenever we attend other classes, participants kindly mute yourself. Yes. So whenever you sit and prepare for some time with the class that you have attended, that will enhance your knowledge. So we give assignments to students continuously every day so that they can prepare more extensively, and then they should apply that knowledge in the test that we give the next day. So basically, we not only teach, we make you study through the course. So when you finish the course, the benefit is you will completely find yourself full with the knowledge. That is, you can be very confident in British literature series. So when you try to attend a test, that is a full mock test, you can be very confident in finding to know that you can attend the 30% of questions on British literature. So we make sure that our students feel very, very confident in attending all the 30 questions that is coming from British literature. So that is very important. We basically give quick notes to make students' revision easy, where we finish all our courses at last. When we go through revision, it will be very, very useful for you. Just you can sit for 1 or 2 hours and you can revise the whole thing, whole syllabus, that is whole 10 units on hand. You can revise it within 2 to 3 hours or 2 hours basically. So that is very, very important. And every day, every course end, we will have discussion on past year's paper, where we do this basically to instill confidence in our students, where students basically fear about how to approach the paper, where they fear that many of this question is unknown for me and I don't know, but I prepared a lot. But the thing is, basically we prepare a lot, but we don't know how to apply our knowledge to find out the answers and eliminate the wrong answers, etc. So this we make them to practice by discussing the questions. So, and finally, after every crash course, we will be giving a full mock test, where, for example, So finally, after each course, you will be also attending a full mock test in which the comprehensiveness of the full course will be tested and you will be given feedback according to that. So between all these 4 courses, we have given a gap except the first 2 course, because it is very short. It is very short, and that doesn't need a long period of time. So that we have given only one day gap between crash course 1 and crash course 2. But when you see the other courses, you will be having 5 days gap in between. This is basically because to make our students revise all those portions which they have gained, they have gone through the 5 days of the crash course, so that they have attended a mock test at the end of the crash course, and they can also make corrections of their own, where we will give them feedback and we will teach them on how to prepare further. So then we'll move on to the next course, that is the crash course 3, 4, and finally the full mock test after completing the 4 crash courses. So after this crash course series also, we are planning to have other crash courses where we are planning to have planning to make free mock tests for our regular students. The preparation will be easy by attending many mock tests. So when you learn alone is not always helpful. When you attend lot of tests and analyze yourself, that will help you lot to prepare and face the exam very confidently. So that is very, very important. So we believe in nothing is impossible when you hold it with a passion. So that is why we make every participant, every student to be confident in the beginning. So the basic three steps for preparation is nothing but first you have to sort out the syllabus for paper one and paper two. You have to see from which you are getting more, and then you have to prioritize the units. That is, among the syllabus you have to prioritize the units, and then you have to make notes, and you have to make the important dates very very notable, where we are giving quick notes for that to remember the dates, and also other important events, other important works, etc. So that will be very helpful for you. And the third step is analyzing yourself, where you should find your comprehensiveness. This comes through constant practice of tests. So this will be also given by Tipster, where you will be given test, and we will also give you feedback on how to correct your mistakes. So this is very well known by our old students, because we had 10 days crash course on theory and criticism, where we had daily assignments and tests in Google Classroom. So we not only teach and give lectures, we teach them the nuances of the question paper so that they feel very, very confident to attend the exam. So that is our main motto. So basically to instill confidence and make everyone to knit their net success story. So that's it. I think I have covered everything. To say about the fee structure of Crash Course series, as we are giving lot of materials every day and tests every day, we have assigned this level of fees. So if any difficulties, you can always contact us. We have given our mail ID here, so that you can mail us and contact, or else you can also contact us in Telegram, where we have a group to have daily discussions on quiz, and you will be given snippets on literature every day, which will be very much useful for NET aspirants. And then we have initiated a WhatsApp group recently for this special lecture that will also be maintained. So please stay with us. And after this session, you will be receiving your certificates after filling the feedback forms. So that will be soon posted in the WhatsApp group, so that you can finish your feedback, and then you will be given the certificates for this special lecture. So that's it. Now I think we can have a discussion. You can post your questions on the presentation done by Nisha ma'am, or else you can also have also post your questions regarding this Grip Your Net course series, so that we can clear your doubts. You can unmute yourself and ask your questions, or else you can also post your questions in chat box.
Ma'am, we are not in WhatsApp group. What to do then?
Those who have registered will be given the ID. Didn't you receive this WhatsApp group ID through mail?
No, ma'am, I didn't receive it.
Please, your name, ma'am?
Preeti.
Okay. So I'll look into it and I'll check, ma'am. We'll check.
We'll check, ma'am, and let you in. Okay.
Any other doubts? You can also visit our website to know more about our crash courses and more about our students' feedbacks, etc. So kindly visit our website. The website link is projected in the slide. Please note it.
Yes, ma'am.
I saw one question in the chat box regarding the name of English by Prachi.
Yes.
The participant part Prachi. One second. Okay. Actually, the name we find it is from the Angel, member of the Germanic people. Actually, they gave the name Angel. We can just see the pronunciation Angel English. So the name actually came from. She has raised a question on that. Is it from Saxons or Angles? So it is from Angles. Actually, Saxon also had their mark on this because they used their vernacular tongue when they used this word English. They used to pronounce in this manner, so they also have their own idea for this. So the Anglo-Saxon only they gave this. Briton was actually taken from Britons, and the name Britain was taken from that phrase. And Anglo-Saxon, the name English or England came from this Anglo-Saxon people. So that was the one question I found in the chat box. Okay.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Yes, Bhargavi, ma'am. Once the recording is ready, we will post it in YouTube so that everyone can have a look on it. Yes, thank you, ma'am. So is there any questions?
Madhu, please inform them that you will be giving the Google form for this upcoming course in the Telegram group and also in WhatsApp group.
Yes, we will.
For new, I think. Please inform that.
Yeah, sure. Yes, we will provide the link for the crash course series in Telegram group and also in the WhatsApp group so that everyone can go through and who are interested can join. We will also provide a WhatsApp link for those who want to join in our WhatsApp group, which has been initiated very recently. So you will be shared the feedback form for this session in WhatsApp group, where you can fill in your feedback and you can receive your certificates for this session. Swati, is there anything you want to tell? You can continue.
There is more, I think. So we shall wind up, I think. So if they have any questions also, they can ask in Telegram or also you can mail us through cracknuteasy@gmail.com. And also you can contact us in this given number. So we think this session will be hopeful for you. It will be very helpful for you. How can we see the video on YouTube, Madhu? There is one.
Yes, Priya ma'am, we'll post the link as soon as possible in our group so that everyone can see. Once the recording is ready, we'll post it.
Excuse me, Madhu, and many of them are asking for the PowerPoint. I will hand it over to you so that you can share it. Kindly inform them also.
Yeah, sure, ma'am, sure. We'll share the slides so that everyone can have a look on it. Please don't worry about it. We are also sharing this recording in YouTube so that everyone can have this lecture on hand every time to make your doubts clear. Is there any other questions?
Madhu?
Yes. Yes, Kausika.
I just have a question regarding the mock test. Yes. As you said, the British Literature course, it has four different divisions, right?
Yes.
So the mock test will be conducted for each division or throughout the sessions, or it's like only one mock test?
The mock test will be on the whole portion for particular crash course. That is, if there is crash course one on early literature, early English literature to revival age, where you will be having that mock test on the final day of the crash course completion. Apart from that, you will be having daily quizzes that you will be attending on every day portions. So you have two tests basically in one course. That is, one is a quiz that you will be attending every day, revising every day's portions. And then finally, after completing one course, you will be having a mock test for the full course that you have attended. And finally, those who have attended all the four courses will be given the mock test on the whole portion of British literature. Is it clear now, Kausika? Am I clear now?
Yes. Thank you, Madhu.
Thank you. Okay, I think there is no more questions, so we can wind up this session. There are three participants who have...
Excuse me, Madhu.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I would like to thank for the opportunity and also the participants who have given so many valuable feedback in the chat box. So I thank you all for this wonderful opportunity given to me. So any doubts and any clarification regarding things can be posted to my mail ID. You can just give my mail ID. You can share it so that they can have any clarifications. Because many of the things were not discussed. As it was a vast topic, many of things might have got left out so that they can have a wider idea about that. So thank you so much.
Yes, we'll share Nisha ma'am's ID, that is mail ID, in our WhatsApp group so that you can also ask questions later. Yes, Preeti ma'am, you will be shared contact number in WhatsApp group. Preeti ma'am, can you please provide your number so that you will be added in the WhatsApp group? Yes, so I think there is no more questions. Raj Kumar has raised hand. Is there any doubt, sir?
Yeah. Hello, good morning, ma'am.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. I just want to know the timing of the class, ma'am.
The
class timing is same for every day, ma'am?
Yes, it will be same for every day, ma'am. From 10 to 1. If we have a little portion, we will be finishing before 1 p.m. So that it will be around from 10 to 1 every day.
Ma'am, I'm working, ma'am. So because of the lockdown, I'm staying at home.
Okay.
So if you are going for the work, means we couldn't attend the classes, ma'am. So what's the possible to see the recordings, ma'am? And how can I submit the assignments, Anna?
Yes, you will be given time, ma'am. Based on your comfortability, we can give you everything. That is assignments and tests. You can attend in your comfortable time. And the classes, if you are unable to attend, you will be shared the slides or you will be shared the recording so that you can go through it and you can ask doubts later in evenings when we are free and you are free. So that is not a problem really. I hope because it is online class, we can have we can make it flexible for your comfortability. Is that okay, ma'am?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Is there any other questions? Navanita Kamachi has raised hand. Is there any doubt, ma'am? Okay, I think there is no more questions, so we can wind up this session. Thank you so much for joining us for this special lecture. So thank you so much for joining us for this special lecture. We thank Nisha ma'am for joining us and giving this informative session on history of English literature in a nutshell that where everyone can get benefit out of it, which will be very, very helpful for the NET aspirants. So with this, we'll finish off this session. If any queries, you can always contact us with the email ID given or you can contact with the phone number. You can also stay connected with us in WhatsApp and Telegram, for which you have shared link already, I hope. So that's it. You can also contact us regarding the Crash Course series at any time. Thank you so much.
Shall I disconnect?
Yes, ma'am, you can.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhubala, and thank you, Swati, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.